Welcome to another lesson, everyone. In my today's discussion, I'm going to describe about pediatric anaphylaxis. So, stay with me till the end. Anaphylaxis is defined as a serious allergic reaction that is rapid in onset and it might cause death. And anaphylaxis in children, particularly infants, is underdiagnosed. Anaphylaxis occurs when there is a sudden release of a potent biologically active mediator from mast cells and the basophils, leading to cutaneous manifestations such as urticaria, angioedema, and flushing, and respiratory manifestations such as bronchospasm and laryngeal edema, and also cardiovascular manifestations such as hypotension, dysarrhythmia, myocardial ischemia, and also gastrointestinal symptoms such as nausea, colic, abdominal pain, vomiting, diarrhea, and the like. When we see the epidemiology and the etiology of anaphylaxis, the most common cause of anaphylaxis in children is different for hospital and the community setting. Anaphylaxis occurring in the hospital results primarily from allergic reaction to medication and latex, whereas food allergy is the most common cause of anaphylaxis occurring outside the hospital, accounting for about half the anaphylactic reaction reported in a pediatric surveys. The incidence of anaphylaxis in children worldwide varies widely, ranging from 1 to 761 per 100,000 person per year for a total anaphylaxis. And the cause of anaphylaxis overall is mostly due to food, around 30 to 34%, around 40 to 20% is due to medication, 90% is due to insect stings, and 7% is due to exercise, and 25 to 60% is idiopathic. This is from, I took this from the study which was done on a large number of population to know the cause of anaphylaxis. Anaphylaxis in hospital, as we have said, is primarily from allergic reaction to medication and the latex, whereas anaphylaxis in the community is mainly from food allergy, and overall food allergy is the most common cause of anaphylaxis. From food allergy, peanut allergy is important cause of food-induced anaphylaxis, accounting for the majority of fatal and the near-fatal reaction. In the hospital, latex is particularly a problem for children undergoing multiple operations such as patients with spina bifida and a urologic disorder, which has prompted many hospitals to switch the latex-free products. Anaphylaxis to galactose, alpha-1-3 galactose, has been also reported 3 to 6 hours after eating red meat. When we see the cause of anaphylaxis overall, the most common, as we have said, is food. From food, the most common ones are peanut, tree nut, milk, egg, shellfish, fruits, and grains. And drugs such as penicillin, cephalosporin, sulfonamides, nonsteroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, opioids, muscle relaxants, vancomycin, dextran, thiamine, vitamin B12, and the like. And also insect venoms, latex, as we have said, allergen immunotherapy, exercise, vaccinations such as tetanus, measles, mumps, and influenza. And also miscellaneous causes such as radio contrast media and the like. When we see the pathogenesis of anaphylaxis, principally the pathologic features in a fatal anaphylaxis include acute bronchial obstruction with a pulmonary hyperinflation, pulmonary edema, intraarterial hemorrhage, and also visceral congestion, laryngeal edema, urticaria, and angioedema. Acute hypotension is attributed to vasometer dilation and the cardiac dysarrhythmia. Most cases of anaphylaxis are believed to be the result of activation of mast cells and basophils via cell-bound allergen-specific IgE molecules. So we classify the pathogenesis as either IgE-mediated or non-IgE-mediated. The IgE-mediated anaphylaxis in most cases are due to activation of mast cells and basophils via cell-bound allergic-specific IgE molecules, and the patients initially must be exposed to the responsible allergen to generate allergen-specific antibody. And when the child is re-exposed to the sensitizing allergen, mast cells and the basophils release a variety of mediators such as histamine, tryptase, and the cytokines that can produce allergic symptoms in all target organs. This is IgE-mediated anaphylaxis. Whereas the non-IgE-mediated anaphylaxis include direct release of mediators from mast cells by medications and the physical factors, for example, such as cold, exercise, and the morphine, some drugs, and the like. And also disturbance of leukotriene metabolism, for example, by aspirin and the nonsteroidal anti-inflammatory drugs, and also by immune aggregates and the complement activation, for example, bread products and the like. The third one is idiopathic anaphylaxis, which is a diagnosis of exclusion where no inciting agent is identified and the other disorders have been excluded. So The pathogenesis of anaphylaxis is classified as IgE mediated anaphylaxis, non-IgE mediated anaphylaxis, and idiopathic anaphylaxis. When we see the clinical manifestation of anaphylaxis, reactions from ingesting allergens such as food, medications are delayed in onset, most of the time minutes to 2 hours, compared with those from injected allergens such as insect sting and the medication, and they tend to have more gastrointestinal symptoms. So ingested allergens have more gastrointestinal symptoms and slightly delayed in onset compared to those injected allergens. Initial symptoms might include any of the following constellation of symptoms, such as pruritus around the mouth and the face, flashing urticaria, angioedema, oral ructanus pruritus, a sensation of warmness, weakness and depression, tightness in the throat, dry staccato cough and hoarseness, nasal congestion, sneezing, dizziness and wheezing, nausea, abdominal cramping, vomiting, especially with ingested allergens, uterine contraction, most of the time manifested as a lower back pain, faintness and the loss of consciousness in a severe cases can all appear, and also cutaneous symptoms may be absent in about 10% of cases. So absence of cutaneous symptoms is, if there is no cutaneous symptom, that doesn't mean there is no anaphylaxis, because cutaneous symptoms may be absent in about 10% of cases. And the acute onset of severe bronchospasm in a previously well person with asthma should suggest the diagnosis of the anaphylaxis. So since there might be no cutaneous symptom, if there is acute onset of severe bronchospasm in a previously well-controlled asthma, should suggest the diagnosis of anaphylaxis. Overall, when we see the symptoms based on systemic symptoms such as hypotension, tachycardia, bradycardia, and hypoxia can happen, and the cutaneous symptoms such as urticaria, angioedema, flashing, and the pruritus can happen, and also HNET, respiratory, cardiovascular, abdominal, genitourinary, neurologic, and psychiatric manifestation can all happen, and they can all assign the symptoms of anaphylaxis. Just to see the laboratory findings on anaphylaxis, laboratory studies might indicate the presence of IgE antibodies to a suspected causative agent, but this result is not definitive, and the plasma histamine is elevated for a brief period, but this is still unstable and difficult to measure in a clinical setting, and the plasma tryptase is more stable and remains elevated for several hours, but often it is not elevated specifically in a food-induced anaphylactic reaction. So still, there is no definitive important thing that helps us to diagnose anaphylaxis by laboratory. So when we see the diagnosis of anaphylaxis, since there is no single laboratory finding that shows anaphylaxis, a National Institute of Health-sponsored expertise panel has recommended an approach to the diagnosis of anaphylaxis. And the differential diagnosis include other forms of shock such as hemorrhagic, cardiogenic, and septic, and the vasopressor reaction including flashing symptoms such as carcinoid syndrome, and also ingestion of monosodium glutamate and hereditary angioedema can all be differential diagnosis. In addition, panic attack, vocal cord dysfunction, pheochromocytoma, Reidman syndrome caused by vancomycin should also be considered as a differential. So the National Institute of Health sponsored expert panel recommended a criteria. They developed a criteria to diagnose anaphylaxis. So anaphylaxis is highly likely when any one of the following criteria are established. The first one is acute onset of illness, that means minutes to several hours, with involvement in skin and the mucosal tissue, such as generalized hives, pruritus or flashing, swollen lips and the tongue and the uvula, and at least one of the following: respiratory compromise, reduced BP or associated symptoms of end organ dysfunction. So if there is acute onset of illness with involvement of skin and the mucosal tissue, and at least involvement of one of either respiratory or reduced BP or associated symptoms, we can diagnose anaphylaxis. The second criteria is two or more of the following that occur rapidly after exposure to a likely allergen for that patient can diagnose anaphylaxis. Those are involvement of the skin and the mucosal tissue, respiratory compromise, reduced BP or associated symptoms, persistent gastrointestinal symptoms. So from these four, if we have two, we can diagnose anaphylaxis if those things occur after exposure to a likely allergen for the patient. So when we see the treatment, anaphylaxis is a medical emergency requiring aggressive management with intramuscular epinephrine. Intramuscular is the first line. Epinephrine I am route to the lateral thigh, which is 1 in 1000 dilution. 0.01 milligram per kg for the maximum of 0.5 milligram should be given, and also the amyloid can be repeated at intervals of 5 to 15 minutes if symptoms persist or worse. Just to see the overall management approach, if we got a patient with anaphylaxis on the field, epinephrine IM is a cornerstone of treatment in anaphylaxis, and EpiPens should be provided to all patients with a non-severe allergic reaction or with risk factors for severe allergy, and also we should have to put the patient on Trendelenburg position. And at the hospital, ABC of life is important. We should have to ensure adequate airway, provide 100% oxygen via face mask, and also establish venous access. And epinephrine IM, if not yet provided, it might be repeated every 15 minutes. If there is inadequate response, IV epinephrine is provided in a case of severe hypotension. And fluid resuscitation, 20 ml per kg NS for pediatrics, and 1 liter bolus NS for adult, continue titrating till we achieve adequate blood pressure. And for a significant dyspnea, nebulized albuterol might be provided with 100% oxygen. Anaphylaxis over also the management, post-emergency management include, after we check the ABC of life, after we give epinephrine and we continue epinephrine every 5 to 15 minutes as needs, antihistamine such as diphenhydramine or cetirizine can be given, and also corticosteroids such as methylprednisolone or prednisolone can be given. And after emergency, the disposition of the patient is, all patients should be observed for at least 4 hours, and admission is based on severity of symptoms and other complications. And the preventive treatment, epinephrine IM auto-injection and antihistamine such as cetirizine or loratadine can be given for 3 days, and the corticosteroid can be also given for 3 days. So after the patient is stabilized, we should have to observe for 4 hours because of biphasic anaphylaxis. Then if there is no biphasic anaphylaxis within 4 hours, we can discharge a patient with epinephrine auto-injection or EpiPen, cetirizine and the prednisolone for 3 days. And allergic action plan should be given for the patient, and the patient should be educated and follow up within 1 week to confirm or determine if presumptive etiology and also allergic consultation is helpful. Just to summarize about anaphylaxis, we should have to suspect anaphylaxis early, and we should have to start management early. In the management, epinephrine IM every 5 to 15 minutes, oxygen, fluid resuscitation, and antihistamine and the corticosteroid is very important. And also, we should have to educate the patient to avoid the causative agent, and we should have to give home EpiPen. Thank you. This is all about anaphylaxis.